produce short-term change, but it will create internal stress because we haven't dealt with the root cause. We haven't looked at the root cause of this problem. Whatever this problem is that we've decided to take on, we haven't looked at why it's happening. And the change doesn't feel natural. Just like I was losing weight with Herbalife, it didn't feel natural. Why? A, it was extremely expensive. It was just liquid stuff I was just drinking, and I was feeling so unhappy. Watch everybody who forces weight loss. They're never happy because so many things are going wrong in the head, and they're thinking, where is this going? I know of a lady who was in my daughter's school, and she was a receptionist, and she was like really big. But what happened? She took on this weight loss that again was unnatural. And I saw her another time and she had become like a little broomstick. And I was in shock. I thought it was her sister or somebody that looked like her. The face was a bit there, but everything else had gone. And I asked her, what were you doing? And she told me, and I thought, okay, let's watch this face. It didn't take long. She was double what she was before. It was unnatural. And that's what happens. It doesn't feel natural, so eventually we give up. We go off the diet, we quit the exercise, we quickly revert to our old patterns. Exactly what happened to the speedboat. There is a better way, he says, and this is an easier way. Change your autopilot. Retuned the autopilot in the speedboat. Change it. Go in there and change that auto. That's the root cause. When you go in there and change what's in there, your life will naturally flow again, just like the speedboat. It will flow back to where you want it to flow to. And so this is the way we think. So in real life, our autopilot is our thoughts. Do you see how he has just explained this whole thing that sounded so complicated? And that's why we call it a new life. Our thoughts is what becomes what pilots us. And so if we want to change our life, we need to go change our thoughts. Our autopilot is the way we think. The Bible says, let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. By changing the way you think. It says our first step in spiritual growth. No, the first part where we went off was the Bible says, let God transform us into a new person by changing the way we think. So it's the way we think that's the issue that we're struggling with. And that was what I was asking earlier. How do we access what helps us to think? What information do we need to encourage our thoughts? And this book is one of the very, very good examples. Because if we are hazy up there, if we're not thinking straight, if we're not getting the right information coming to us, our thoughts is not right. And that's where we are. So getting the right information helps to provide us with a better way of thinking. And so our first step in spiritual growth is to change the way we think. So remember, as spirits that we are, we need to change the way we think. Change always starts first in the mind. So change starts from inside. And that's why the caterpillar changes from caterpillar into a butterfly. It's something that's internal. It's inward. Change doesn't come from outside. And that's why when we take on willpower to go and change the way we look at our health, it doesn't work. Because we need to understand why we need health. We need to know what the food we're eating brings to us. And this is one area that I'm also very excited about, because I have my new program. I call it NutriLife. And NutriLife is all about nutrients. What nutrients are you putting into your body? It's not about losing weight and looking the part. It's about, are you healthy? Have you put the right nutrient in that will keep you healthy? So if you don't understand it from inside, how are you going to be able to handle the food you eat? Because you see that if someone's forcing food into your body, You're thinking, you're forcing me to taste something I don't like. It comes from inside. So a new life starts in our mind, which is our thoughts. So the way we think determines the way we feel. So if something happened to me and I'm thinking about it, that thought will create my feeling. And it's my feeling that will now start pushing me into various actions. So the way we feel influences the way we act. Our feeling becomes the action we take on. So if someone said something to me and I didn't like it, and I felt so, and I'm reacting so badly to it, I will feel something, and the feeling is I'm really sad and I'm upset. And it's that action of being sad and upset that will lead me into taking a reaction to maybe the person or to people around me. So Paul said, there must be a spiritual renewal of your thoughts and attitudes. So the thought has to be changed, and it has to be spiritual. To be like Christ, we must develop the mind of Christ. The New Testament calls this mental shift. Mental shift, which in Greek means to change your mind. So mental shift repentance. That's what this is saying. It says when spiritually we change, the Bible calls it mental shift repentance. And this means change your mind. We repent whenever we change the way we think. So every time you say, okay, I repent, you know, the Bible, you know, as Christians, we always say, I repent of my sin. It means I have changed from the way I was thinking. So we repent whenever we change the way we think by adopting how God thinks about ourselves. So we should be looking at how God thinks about us, not about how we think about whatever it is. So the way God thinks about ourselves, the way God thinks about sin, the way God thinks about other people, the way God thinks about life, about our future, and about everything that we do. And so I give the example, love God, love your neighbors as yourself. That's a good example. That's what God wants from us. So again, that's repentance. So you're repenting. You're changing the way you think about other people. Even when they don't love you, you love them. Our life here is limited, so we will not take anything with us to eternity. God sees who we are, not what we are. So these are the things that God thinks about. God sees who we are, not what we are. Life is a test. We've been told that in the previous chapters. Life is a trust. What are these things that God gave us to do? We belong to God's family. Unity, not uniformity. For the good of the whole, etc., etc. That's how God thinks about us. And these are the things we need to take on board. Turn into a butterfly. We gain a new life. We gain new energy to life. So we are commanded to think the same way that Christ Jesus taught. There are two ways of doing this. The first half is a mental shift. It's to stop thinking immature thoughts. So what are immature thoughts? These are self-centered and self-seeking thoughts. So whenever our thoughts are constantly about ourselves, these are immature thoughts. Remember, the whole passage here is about, this whole chapter is about us growing. That's what we are interested in. We want to grow. We started the chapter with, as children, most of us want to remain in diapers. Most of us want to remain in nappies. Most of us want to remain in booties. We don't want to grow. And here he's trying to tell us that we have to stop thinking self-centered and self-seeking thoughts. The minute we start remain thinking like that, we remain children. We don't grow. And so, Bible says, stop thinking like children. That's exactly what we just talked about. The Bible said to us, we should stop thinking like children. In regard to evil, be infants, but in your thinking, be adults. That's the Bible talking to us. In regard to evil, be infants. Because when it comes to evil, children are so ignorant. They don't know what evil is. And so I remember that passage in the Bible said, unless you are as a child, you cannot pass through the eye of a needle, or you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven unless you're a child. And so when he's referring to that, it's about evil. If we could let go and not even be involved with evil, like children are so innocent, then that's fine. We can be children there. But when it comes to thoughts, we should start thinking like mature people, like grown-ups. Stop thinking like children in regard to evil, be infants. But in your thinking, be adults. So babies by nature are completely selfish. So he's trying to explain this to us, which is why he said self-centered thoughts and self-seeking thoughts are the problem. Babies, they think they are extremely selfish. They think only of themselves and their own needs. And after I read this, and when I was chatting with my son, and I think I asked him to do something for me, is that money? Oh, and I said, oh, that book was right then. It's all about you then. He said, Mom, but I'm not like that. It was funny. But look at a baby, and not just babies. Young children, they just want me, 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 me. That's all they're interested in. They have no clue what we talk about for the good of the whole. Not for children. They don't think that far. For them, it's all about themselves. Self-centered thoughts. They are incapable of giving. They can only receive. Children just want to give me, give me, give me. They don't want to give. They just want to take, receive. This is immature thinking. He's telling us how this is so immature. Unfortunately, many people never grow beyond this kind of thinking. Many people remain children in adult age. And that's why he explained earlier that Christians don't want to grow. They just grow in numbers, but they don't grow in actual reality of what life should be. Bible says selfish thinking is the source of sinful behavior. Those who live following their sinful selves think only about things that their sinful selves want. How amazing is this? How amazing is this? Because all you're thinking about is yourself, yourself, yourself. That leads you to sin, because that's all that's coming out. The second half of thinking like Jesus is to start thinking maturity, which focuses on others, not yourself. So the bad part, or the unhealthy part, is self-centered and self-seeking. And now we've been advised to think more as matured people. And as matured people, we should think like Jesus did, which was focusing on other people. Remember, love people. Focusing on other people, not just ourselves. In his great chapter on what real love is, Paul concluded that thinking of others is a mark of maturity. So Paul told us clearly, thinking of other people is the mark of maturity. In his great chapter on what real love is, Paul concluded that thinking of others is a mark of maturity. So you remember, we've been told over and over, love others, love others, love people, love God, love people, love God. What is love? That's a big question. And Paul has reminded us here clearly, thinking of other people is the mark of maturity. And that's where love is. You're thinking of other people, not just yourself. And as humans, it's just a natural tendency for us to just think about ourselves. Self-centered, self-seeking. And he explains it. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. When he became a man, he put all those childish ways behind him. And that's what maturity is about. That's what spiritual maturity is about. Not just about self-seeking and self-centeredness. Because imagine what the world would be like if all of us could think of other people for a change and not just ourselves. I don't think we'll be having wars all over the place and this extreme poverty and extreme wealth will not be happening because it will matter to us what other people have, not just ourselves. So imagine that we're not going anywhere with all that. Today, many assume that spiritual maturity is measured by the amount of biblical information and doctrine we know. That's what most Christians, that's what we all think. And I know so many churches out there, especially in Nigeria and Africa, who just want to prey on ignorant, poor people. They just prey on them. And when I mean pray, I don't mean P-R-A-Y, P-R-E-Y. They just use them as... I can't even begin to describe how I feel about these things. When somebody will call himself a pastor and all he wants is to take away from the little that the poor people have, they take it and hide under, they want to pray for them. They want, when they keep coming to that church, their life will change. They will have everything they want. This book is telling us differently. It's not about the material things that we've been sent here for. We've all been sent here with major messages. This is one of the messages. For us to understand that life is not about what we are thinking. It's just thoughts that are in our head that's causing the problem. And we need to clear it. We need to clear the minds of our people not to be used by these people who all they have been, as far as I know, they're serving Satan. You cannot be serving God and not love these people that come to your church and all you want to do is use them. Use them to climb to such heights that all you travel with is private jets and live in some fancy world that doesn't exist. And then when it's over, you're not going anywhere with all of that. That is worrisome. And that's not maturity. That's just childishness. That's self-centered and self-seeking. If you claim you're coming to them with the word of God to help them see a better life, and all you've done is take from them, like a child, take, receive, and you don't give anything back. This book is telling us clearly that you haven't grown up, that you are a child. Today, many assume that spiritual maturity is measured by the amount of biblical information and doctrines you know. So they will preach everything they can preach. They will speak with tongues. There's one video that I saw went viral, and this lady is calling every name under the sun in the name of God. And maybe her congregation is thinking, oh my goodness, she is so spiritual. These are all lies. Learn to live with other people and love other people and love God. And start to bring out the trust that God gave you, the message God gave you. And start to think new thoughts. The thoughts that's accommodating and receptive to other people. And you develop that spiritual maturity. This is so touching to know. Most of us are super selfish. It is always about us first, before anyone else. And I'll just explain it. The politicians in Africa, they don't want that continent to grow. They don't want that continent to grow. You hear the stories, you see the money. One time I saw a video where it's like the foundation of a building and they stack so much, not Naira, that's where I'm from. I don't know what other currencies are in other countries of Africa. These were dollars that they stacked to create the foundation of a building. Who does that? Only in Africa. And yet we sit here and we cry about slavery and we cry about how our people are being maltreated and not treated well. And right there in our own country, People are destroying other people. What is that money doing in the ground? What is it doing in the ground? Do you remember the parable of I can't remember what that parable is called, where this master gave his servants money and said, get one five talents, the parable of talents. Get one 10, get one 5, and get one 2 or something like that. And the other two went to do business with their money, and the third one dug the ground and put the money there. And when the master came back, and then the other two had made money on the money that he gave them, they'd made profit. And they gave it to him and said, "Master, when you left, we did business with the money you gave us. This is what came out of it." And the other one, "Oh well, I know that you're a very wicked man, and I didn't know what to do with it. I was worried that if I lost the money, you do things to me. So I didn't do anything with the money. I dug the ground and I put it in. That's your money." And he ended up being sent to prison because he was the one who was wicked. So that's what's going on here. You live in a country where there's so much poverty, where there are no infrastructure, and you dig the ground and you bury money because you don't think there's anything we could do with that money. You don't think people are starving enough. You don't think people are suffering enough on this same earth that God sent all of us to do different things. You have not allowed people to bring out, you know, whatever God gave them to do, because they can't think. Obviously, if your source of thoughts is so messed up because you haven't been able to attend any education, you know, go to school or gain any education because you haven't had access to basic things of life, how can you possibly pull yourself out of that scenario? The message here is spiritual immaturity is all about self-centeredness and self-seeking. And there's so many examples that can tell you when someone is spiritually immature. Take an example of, we've talked about a church leader, we've talked about politicians, we've talked about business people who take on businesses, and all they want to do is cheat their clients. Whatever they can do to just take money from the clients, they will invent every way possible. Remember when we had the Wall Street crash? Because someone who used to work in Wall Street actually came onto a channel I watched, I think it was Russian TV. And he said all they ever do is sit there and invent new ways of taking money from people. And so they will just call it another thing, and they will call it another thing, and they will call it another thing. Just so that people think, oh yeah, there's a new one that's called. I am extremely cynical about banking because I worked in the bank and I know what it's about. It's just about making money and taking money off people. And so you go and you put deposit your money in the bank, and they practically give you no interest, and then they are going to give that money out to other people as credit, and then they're charging them ridiculous rates. And even here, when we put money in the bank, they charge you for putting money in the bank, they charge you for withdrawing money from the bank, they charge you when your bank account goes into overdraft, they charge you for waking up. And that's political, spiritual immaturity. Because you may call it capitalism all you like. People are being used just to make other people happy. If we could just love each other, and be just a tiny little bit caring, you may capitalize all you like, but just be a bit more human. You see, we come from one race, human race, but no, we want to destroy anybody else that's on our path. And look at the cases of marriage. So you got a husband and wife come together, yes, let's get married and let's have one whole idea of what our future will be. We want to do this, we want to do this, we want to do this. And then you have instances of a wife, all she wants to do is hide every money in the family. And she will just keep hiding it and looking for different things to say. I know of a lady who every money she earned was hidden away. And all she ever wanted to spend was her husband's money. And while she was hiding the money away, she had gone to her village and was building massive houses. And the poor man was made to walk and walk and walk. And what do you think will happen next? Of course he will break his back and die. Early grave. Because he got married. Is it a sin to be married? You thought you were in love? Oh, you don't want to go into husbands. Who in their selfish way of thinking, spiritual immaturity, they're thinking, ooh, where is that toy that I forgot to amass when I was a child? Girlfriends. And so they pile on and pile on various girlfriends, and one is here, one is there, one is there. And in their selfish way of thinking, it's giving them such pleasure. They have girlfriends everywhere. They're not thinking about the implication of what that means when their wife would know, and then things start to go wrong. Selfishness, self-seeking, self-centered. It's all about me, me, me. Let me receive, let me receive, let me receive, let me not give. And that's what this spiritual immaturity is trying to tell us. To wake up from it and start being more caring about other people. So it says selfishness all around. Children want to waste parents' money on ridiculous gadgets. Politicians want to steal every money that they can find in the country. Pastors stealing money from the church congregation. And it just goes on and on. Spiritual maturity demands more than just biblical information. So that's what spiritual maturity is about. You have to grow and learn to care about other people. The Christian life is more than creeds and convictions. Oh yeah, the creed said. It includes conducts and characters. Remember, we talked on character in one of the chapters. It includes conduct. How do you conduct yourself? And what kind of character do you possess? Our deeds must be consistent with our creeds. So the action we take must be consistent with whatever we've learned. And our beliefs must be backed up with Christ-like behavior. Whatever beliefs we take on, they must be backed up by the way Christ wants us to see these things. Christianity is not a religion or a philosophy, but a relationship and a lifestyle. So again, you hear people who want to talk down on Christianity. Oh yeah, your religion is so. Yes, but you know what? I will question that, because yes, there are so many Christians out there who don't behave Christian-like. They do not behave Christ-like. There are so many who are not interested in the welfare of the next person, who all they want to do is just themselves. In my training, when people come here giving you skills, I commit. Whenever someone pays me money and say, please, I want to learn this, I commit. Because my focus is to empower you. That's my focus. I want to make sure you gain the reason you came here. And all I ask from you is you commit yourself too. You commit by giving me some money that I've asked for, which is to help provide the amenities, the electricity, the building, the time that I'm going to be with you. All of that is why I said pay X amount. Or you decide to buy the home training, again, pay X amount, because in here is so much information that will empower you for life. And so when I'm dealing with people, I bring all of me on the table. But you're going to find people who will rather look for ways to steal from people, to take and not give anything back. But life is about give and take. It's about you give me something, I give you something. Christianity is a relationship and a lifestyle. The lifestyle of Jesus. People have to be careful the kind of Christians they look at. That's what this book is reminding us. And it's telling us what the real life out there is about. The core of this lifestyle is thinking of others as Jesus did, instead of thinking of ourselves alone. So now be very curious. Whenever you see all those churches out there, which I call them celebrity pastors, or there's another name I call them. I don't want to say fake pastors. But they want to be on the podium and being praised by their congregation and being put on a pedestal like they are God himself when they are nothing. They are just as human as you are. And I hear people go, oh, and this person, the father of this and the... No, please wake up. Wake up. We're looking at a new life. And so the core of this lifestyle is about thinking of others as Jesus did. So the core of Christian life is about thinking of others as Jesus did, not just about ourselves alone. Big message from this chapter. We should learn to think of others, not just ourselves. We should go away from the self-centeredness and the self-seekingness and think about other people as well. Bible says we should think of their good and try to help them by doing what pleases them as well. Even Christ did not try to please himself. Thinking of others is the heart of Christian Christ-likeness and the best evidence of spiritual growth. Thinking of others, that's when you start knowing if you're mature enough spiritually. This kind of thinking is unnatural, is countercultural, is rare, and is difficult to attain. So when you start thinking like this, start reminding yourself, yes, it is hard, yes, it is tough, but that's what I'm aiming to become. That's the spiritual way I want to go. So fortunately, we have help. God has given us his spirit, and that's why we don't think the same way that the people of this world think. So when we start taking on this role of developing a new life, the big thing we have to start thinking now is not the way other people think. Our thoughts have to start changing. So this is the end of this chapter, and I hope you got a lot of message out of it. But before we finish, as usual, we do our usual thing. And then we ask the question, what is the one area where I need to stop thinking about me and my own way and start thinking God's way? What is the one area in your life? It may not be one. And what are the areas in your life that you need to come out of and not just think about yourself alone? And so meditation is, let God transform you inwardly by a complete change of your mind. God is going to transform us from inside. Then you will be able to know the will of God. Remember, we're trying to understand our purpose. What is good and is pleasing to him and is perfect? We want to know what is good and pleasing to him. And what is perfect? And this is Romans chapter 12, verse 2. So a new lifestyle starts with new thoughts. That's me telling you this. A new lifestyle, a new life, we're thinking of a new life. It starts with our thoughts. A new way of thinking. A new way of viewing things. Being born a new person. Being born again, as some people will call it. For us to start thinking God's thoughts and take things away from self-centeredness to other people's centeredness. So that's how God thinks. God thinks other-centeredness. And we naturally think self-centeredness. We need to start changing that. So thank you so much for watching this. And please remember to share this with your friends. This whole book is going to help transform the way we look at our lives. We want you to try and subscribe as well, because remember, it's a 40-day program. It's not a one day, one chapter. You are not going to get the full message from just watching one episode. Try your best to watch the whole thing. Stay tuned with us. Subscribe. Share with your friends. Help people to change their life. We look forward to seeing you in the next chapter, and God bless you abundantly.